I hope this
Yeah,
works.
perfect.
Okay,
Yeah.
that's fine. So, yeah, okay. My name is Gero Kreuzfeld. I'm located in Germany and I'm the head of the software development team at CF Turbo. So I will start with a short presentation here to give you some quick facts about the company CF Turbo itself and an introduction about CF Turbo software. And afterwards, I would switch to the software and give you a live demo of designing a pump. Okay, some words to the company. We are located, or the headquarters is located in Dresden in Germany. This is south of Berlin in East Germany. And we have another office, a sales office in New York in the US. Our fields of activity are mainly focused on the CF Turbo software. This is our main business. So we are developing these conceptual design software, organizing training, custom development, and so on. So this is the main focus of the webinar today. Then the second field is consulting in the field of turbo machinery design and simulation. This is more, I would say, a regional business in Central Europe. And the third one is overwritten as workflows. This is the combination of the first and the second field. So we are developing automated workflows for different systems in order to be able to run design exploration and optimization with CF Turbo and simulation systems. Yeah, we have distributors all over the world, and as we just heard, we have started a distributorship in South Africa just a few weeks ago, and therefore we are in this webinar today. Okay, what is CF Turbo? It's a conceptual design software for impeller stators and volutes, so the main parts of turbo machines. And we can design pumps, fans, compressors, and turbines, and these are the four main types of turbo machinery. CF Turbo is supporting the main types of impeller. These are axial, centrifugal, and mixed flow type. And we are supporting a lot of blade shapes, mainly driven by manufacturing limitations. Like ruled surface, for instance, or radial elements, or helical type for end users, and so on, very special shapes. Yeah, we are on the market since 15 years now, starting in 2005, and currently we have about 200 customers globally. What is the workflow using CF Turbo? Normally, the user is starting with specifying the design point of the machine. That means a flow rate, an energy transmission, is a head or pressure difference, rotational speed, selecting the fluid and some inlet condition, and that's all for the starting input. What CF Turbo is using are all the fundamental fluid equations, so the well-known Bernoulli-Euler equation, the conservation equations, the relations in the velocity triangles, and all these physics of turbo machinery. Furthermore, we are using extensively empirical correlations. And these correlations can be customized by the user if he has specific knowledge about his specific product. So that means we have not invented a completely new design system or design method, but we have collected all the available knowledge from books and presentations and so on, and implemented it into the software CF Turbo. So of course you can import existing geometry for comparing designs, or really for redesigning existing geometry. And at the end, what CF Turbo is generating is 3D geometry. That means a 3D CAD model of the fluid and or the solid domain of the machine. And this model is fully parametric. And in combination with a lot of export interfaces and the batch mode capability of CF Turbo, this software can be integrated in all kinds of automated workflows for design exploration, optimization, or simply for automatically calculating performance curves. Okay, if we are looking on the design process, CF Turbo is located just at the beginning of this process. And afterwards, you have, in general, these two possibilities. You can use meshing and simulation systems to come very quickly to flow results. So this is the modern approach. But of course, you can alternatively use, or in addition use, the traditional approach using CAD interfaces of CF Turbo and using rapid prototyping to run experiments. So, of course, it is clear that this is not a one-way method. So based on the testing results, you have to step back normally to the design system. This is what we see here. Make modifications in the design system in CF Turbo based on the results and run the loop again. So that means an iterative approach is required always, and these loops for optimization can be run interactively or manually based on the experience, or it can be run automatically using an optimization software or design exploration software. Okay, here you can see some examples that are designed in CF Turbo. So there are very different types of impellers visible, different blade shapes. So for instance, these simple 2D blades for a centrifugal pump with low specific speed, for instance, a mixed flow pump, compressor impeller with splitter blades, which is very typical for compressors, for instance, some guide vanes here in red color for a radial inflow turbine, an inducer, and so on. So we have very different, or we are supporting very different types of these machines. Okay, this is an overview about the interfaces of CF Turbo. So in our opinion, the most important simulation systems for turbine machinery are supported. Of course, ENSYS is on the top position as the market leader in this field, but also NUMEKA or Samarix or Siemens with CCM Plus are strong partners in this business. Okay, if we are focusing on the ENSYS interfaces, there are three alternative possibilities to work with ENSYS products in combination with CF Turbo. The first one is the classical approach using ISIM CFD. So we have developed a script solution that is run inside ISIM, and this provides a fully automated meshing, unstructured meshing of all components designed in CF Turbo, so that you come very quickly to simulation results using CFX or Fluent. The second one is the integration of CF Turbo in the workbench using the ENSYS meshing or the TurboGrid mesher. And that's exactly the content of the second part of this webinar. And the third method is using ENSYS OptiSlang. So CF Turbo, we are cooperating with OptiSlang for a lot of years now. And the guys of OptiSlang have integrated a CF Turbo node in OptiSlang so that our software is directly supporting in OptiSlang to build optimization workflows like in this picture here. So this is the position of CF Turbo here in this workflow. Okay, that's it for a short introduction, and I would like to switch over to the software now. So this is the user interface of CF Turbo. I would like to design a pump here for demonstration. So therefore, I start a new project. What we see automatically is the so-called global setup. And this is the position where we have to define or specify the design point. So that means I have to put in a few numbers here, mainly 3 for the flow rate, for the head, and for the rotational speed of the machine. The fluid is water. You can select different fluids. There's a fluid database behind CF Turbo, and you can add your own fluids, so there's a high flexibility. So of course, the inlet conditions are important mainly for NPSH and for the simulation later, of course. So you see on the right side, you get some information about the specific speed. So it's 39 is example. That means we are in the area of typical centrifugal pumps. And we get the information about the position in the well-known Cordier diagram to check where we are, which type of machine is suitable for this design point. Okay, we are starting with an empty project now, and now we can step by step add different components to this project. And yeah, most important is the impeller, and therefore, of course, I will start with adding a new impeller here in this design. So this automatically opens the so-called main dimensions of the impeller. So we see in this impeller menu here on top all the different design steps. So we are starting with the main dimensions here. This is required. And then step by step, we are continuing designing the impeller up to the blade edges. And afterwards, we can add additional components to our project. So these are the main dimensions. This is split in 3 parts. The setup to specify some global parameters of the impeller, like shrouded or unshrouded designs, splitter blades, and so on. The second part is specifying parameters. And here a lot of empirical correlations are running in the background. That means you get default values for all these parameters, recommended ranges that can be selected. You can check what is behind or where this recommendation comes from. This is all available. And of course, you have to make a guess about the efficiency values of your pump. And also for these values, there is an empirical correlation in the background that gives you typical efficiencies for these flow rate and for these specific speed. And on the last page here, the main dimension itself are calculated. So that means the suction diameter, impeller diameter, outlet width of the impeller, and you get an idea about how the meridional shape looks like in general. And you get some initial ideas about the general shape of the velocity triangles and the outlets are out of pressure differences, rotational speed and all this stuff, some NPSH estimations based on different models and so on. So there's a lot of information available. So we see we have specified only a few numbers, and now we are stepping to the next design step. This is the meridional design. So we have here we have to specify the hub and the shroud curves as well as the leading edge position. So this is all based on Bezier curves. We can combine different Bezier curves or straight lines. So there are a lot of options available for all these curves. We can add inlet and outlet elements in front and behind curves and so on. So there's a lot of flexibility to create complex meridional geometries. So and we have a lot of additional information available. So I have opened here the curvature distribution and the area distribution, but there are some more available. So, and yeah, for instance, we can adapt the geometry and see what is the influence on the curvature and the area distribution, for instance, here to make it as smooth as possible. Furthermore, there's a very simple flow calculator available based on a frictionless method. So that means it's very fast solution, but it's very simple, and the simulation results are, of course, not on the same level like a CFD simulation, but gives you some information about the overall velocity level and distribution in this passage. Okay, then the next design step are the so-called blade properties. This is the basic specification of the blading parameters. First, the number of blades and the number of spans has to be selected. So spans are these intermediate sections between hub and shroud where the blade is designed later. Then we can select these different blade shapes which are available for this type of machine. So I would use the Freeform 3D, which is the most flexible at the moment, but this depends highly on your manufacturing limitation. Okay, then you have to define the blade thickness because the blade blockage is very important for calculating the blade angles on leading and trailing edge. You can define an incidence angle, and you have to select one of the available slip models to estimate the deviation between the flow direction and the blade direction. So this is very typical for these blade design or blade angle calculation, and these angles are calculated here on the second page, where the blade angles on the leading edge are calculated based on a shockless inflow, and on the trailing edge based on the well-known Euler equation of turbo machinery to get the specified head of the design point. Yeah, on the right side, you get a lot of information about all the velocity components, the deviation angle, the incidence angle, velocity ratios, and so on. And you got detailed information about the velocity triangles. The thick line is the direction of the blade, the thin line is the flow. Therefore, you get an idea about the deviation or the slip angle on the trailing edge, and you see the shockless inflow here on the leading edge. Okay, then the next design step are the blade meanline design. And here are different options available. What we see here is the so-called conformal mapping. This is exactly the same like the definition in ANSYS. I think it's M prime theta, the name of these conformal mapping in ANSYS. And alternatively, you could specify a blade angle distribution or a blade loading distribution to use an inverse design approach. So you can now modify the shape of the mean lines using these Bézier points. And you can control, for instance, the beta distribution here in this diagram. You can have an idea about the 3D shape of the blades. And of course, there are a lot of different information available, which can be switched on and off here in this menu. Okay, and again, also for the blading, there's a simple calculation available for the blade-to-blade flow. That gives you an idea about the velocity level and maybe indicating some areas of possible recirculation near the blades and so on. Okay, we have now the mean surface design finished. That means we have a blade without any thickness, and therefore the next step will be the profiling of the blades. In this profiling, there's a lot of flexibility possible in general. So you can add control points, remove them, load any thickness distribution, or using some predefined profiles from the integrated profile manager like NACA profiles and so on. But I think this is more for the actual design, and for the centrifugal pumps, it's quite typical to have a constant thickness distribution or maybe a linear modified distribution. like this. Okay, and you see what we have on the screen is now the thickness of the blades, but you see there's no rounding at leading and trailing edge. And that's exactly the last design step. So here we can specify the rounding of the leading edge. So it's this elliptic shape, what we see here on the leading edge with a certain axis ratio. Or alternatively, you could use a Bezier type. And yeah, there you have a lot of flexibility to make it symmetric or asymmetric or something like that. Or you could use this linear approach where you have these linear reducing blade thickness and the rounding on the top side. And you have some parameters to influence the shape. So I think the elliptic one is quite typical. And on the trailing edge of the centrifugal impellers, the typical shape is this simple blade shape and a cutoff on the outlet surface. And that's exactly defined here. Okay, that's it. And now our design is finished. There are some additional features available, like some CFD preparation, so generating the segment around a single blade, or adding some extension to improve the meshing in the meshing system later. But I think that due to the limited time, I cannot introduce all these features now. So I would like to very quickly add a volute here. So therefore I use this plus button, adding a new component. And there are again several different design steps, specifying the inlet. Then the next one is selecting the general shape of the section. There can be different definitions depending on the circumferential direction. So I would make it very simple here and select a round type only for the whole 360 degree here. Then the next one is specifying calculating the spiral contour itself. So there are different approaches available here. Yeah, the most well-known are Flyder and Stepanov theory, and they are available here. Or alternatively, you could switch to a geometry-based design and can specify a progression of the radius or the area or the ratio area to radius. So there are different possibilities available here. And then the next design is the diffuser design. So you could select a tangential diffuser or a radial diffuser or a spline diffuser. This is a more flexible geometry. Yeah, you can define that the length of the diffuser, the diameter of the end cross section, and so on. So, and then the last design step is the cutwater design. So there are different options available. You can select a radius of the cutwater, or yeah, it's like the edge of a blade, you can imagine. And that's it. And now we have a completely finished geometry here on the screen, containing an impeller and the volute. So of course, you see there's a gap between impeller and volute, which is quite typical for security reasons and avoiding vibration and noise. And of course, you have to close this gap, and there are several alternative possibilities available. You can simply close the gap using, let's say artificial CFD geometry that is available in CFTurbo. Or you could alternatively add the solid design of hub and shroud here on both sides and design the secondary flow path completely to connect the volute with the casing in front of the impeller. This is in general possible. So to show you very quickly, a very quick connection would be this simplified geometry to avoid calculating or simulating the complete secondary flow path. So this is one option. And for CFD preparation, I would add an inflow area, a completely axial type here, something like this. So this can be done very quickly by a few mouse clicks. And the same for the outlet side. On the volute, I can define an extension with a certain length. So something like that. And that means at the end, I have a completely watertight CFD model, including an inflow area here on that side and an outflow area here on that side behind the volute. So, and this geometry is ready for simulation, and I now could use some of the export interfaces that are available in CF Turbo. So the direct interfaces to the CAD systems, or of course, any of the CFD interfaces available in CF Turbo. Yeah, that's it for a very short introduction of CF Turbo. Of course, I could show you the most important features only. There are a lot of more available, of course. And I would hand over to my colleague, Sasha, and he is introducing the Ansys Workbench integration to create automated workflows in the Ansys environment.
All right, thank you, Garu. Introduction. I would like to share my screen. And yeah, I would like to start. So a very warm welcome to our today's presentation about the integration of CF Turbo into Ansys Workbench. My name is Sascha Henoch. I'm also located at our headquarters in Dresden, Germany. And I'm a CAE engineer at CF Turbo since 2018. Today's session is about the integration of CF Turbo into Ansys Workbench. So at the beginning, I would like to give you a short introduction. I will talk about the prerequisites that are necessary to define and the settings you need to adjust to make everything work. I will give you a short theoretical presentation how it works, and then we skip over to the live demo and integrate CF Turbo into Ansys Workbench using a centrifugal pump. Okay. So CF Turbo can be integrated into Ansys Workbench since CF Turbo 4.4. The extension enables the integration of CF Turbo into Ansys workflows. It allows a bidirectional parameter update between CF Turbo and Ansys Workbench. So what this means, I will explain further during the live demo. A big benefit is the automatic creation of named selections for space claim exports, which makes the downstream located workflows a lot easier. So it improves your data processing and Ansys meshing, as well as in CFX pre and CFD post. And all in all, you decrease the time you spend on the pre-processing. And of course, you fortify the robustness of your workflows. And like Garu said, it also enables an automatic turbo machinery optimization using different tools. For example, the Design Explorer that is shipped with Ansys Workbench, or using external software like Dynaris OptiSlang. Okay, let's talk about the prerequisites. Of course, you need to install the extension, and there are currently two ways. The first way would be to install the CF Turbo Ansys Workbench extension during the CF Turbo installation. If you choose this way, the extension will be available for all users on the workstation, and the extension data will be copied into the Ansys installation directory. A second way would be by downloading the extension for free from our website, cfturbo.com. You would use the Ansys Workbench Extension Manager to install the extension, and the extension would only be available to the current user. Sorry. and your data would be copied into the app data directory of the user. There are additional prerequisites that need to be defined in order to make use of the named selections feature. There is a setting inside of Ansys Workbench that needs to be enabled, and it's located inside of the Ansys Workbench options inside of the geometry import section, and there's an option called basic options with named selections, and you just have to make sure that this option is enabled and the filtering prefix is set to the standard value NS. Okay, how does it work? So after the installation of the extension, you will find a new entry named CF Turbo inside of the Ansys toolbox. And as you, as it well known, you just enable a new CF Turbo system inside of the project schematic, either using a drag and drop action or by performing a double click and create a new CF Turbo system. In the next step, you would edit the setup node of the CF Turbo system to open CF Turbo from inside Ansys Workbench. You could load or create a new design of your turbo machinery, and you can also configure different geometry parameters because all our turbo machinery components are fully parameterized, and you can define different export actions using the Ansys Workbench entry in CF Turbo. This is another screenshot of the Ansys Workbench menu. So you can see we have currently two export interfaces. You have the option to export our components to Ansys Base Claim, or you could export vein components like vein stators or impellers to TurboGrid. Like I said, when you're done, you exit CF Turbo, you just confirm the save dialog, and the creation of named selections is currently optional. By default, it is enabled. Of course, to save some time during the data processing, if you don't need named selections, for example, you can always disable the option. But like I said, by default, it's enabled since there are a lot of benefits during the whole workflow exists. Yeah, and then you just update the CF Turbo setup cell and your export. In the next step, you link them to adjacent systems for the meshing, and all in all, you transfer all the meshes to a CFX system, for example, and start building up your workflow. But this is something we will see in the next couple of minutes, so don't worry if this was a little bit fast. All right, so and now I would like to skip over to the live demo. So here you can see an empty Workbench project. If I go to manage extension, you can see we have installed the CF Turbo Workbench extension. It's also enabled by default. And we have set the necessary prerequisite regarding the named selection. So I'm going to check it again by going to the geometry import, scrolling down a little bit. And here you can see that the named selections option has been enabled and that the filtering prefix is set to an S. Okay. So in the next step, I'm going to create a new CF Turbo system by performing a drag and drop operation to the project schematic. I'm going to edit the setup cell of this newly created CF Turbo system. And CF Turbo is going to be opened. For today, I have already prepared a CF Turbo design. Therefore, I'm going to select the CF Turbo file. And I'm going to choose the radial pump with a specific speed of 42. And as you can see, our current design consists of three components, an inlet stator, radial impeller, as well as volute. if we check our operation point, I can go to the global setup and you can see that our pump is designed to develop a head of 10 meters at a volume flow rate of 200 cubic meters per hour and at 1000 revolutions per minute. Our transport medium is water, and that gives us all in all a specific speed of 42. If we're going to switch to the 3D model, you can see I have selected circular to D plate type. The calculation of the plate angles at the outlet is performed automatically by CF Turbo in order to meet our operation point. I have also enabled the option for the volute to add an volute extension to move our outflow boundary conditions for the CFD simulations further downstream. And if I'm happy with my design and I don't want to change anything, I'm going to prepare it for the transfer to ANSYS Workbench by opening the ANSYS Workbench menu. And here you can see structure 3 containing all the geometric parameters that define our geometry. So for example, if I'm going to open the main dimensions dialog, you can see we have access to the hub diameter as well as the suction diameter, the outlet width and the impeller diameter of our impeller component. And we can activate these parameters here and they will be transferred into the parameter set inside of ANSYS Workbench. So for today's example, I maybe want to select the outlet width as well as the impeller diameter. Maybe I want also to modify the number of plates. Therefore, I'm going to open the plate properties and select the parameter for the number of plates. And maybe I will also want to modify my volute. Therefore, I'm going to open this menu, go to spiral areas, and maybe I'm going to select the swirl exponent, which describes the area progression of the volute in respect to the volute rep. And that's all. So we don't have access to the plate angles currently because they are automatically calculated by CF Turbo in order to meet our operation point. But you can always disable this automatic calculation. But in this case, you wouldn't. There's no guarantee you would meet your designed operation point. Therefore, this automatic calculation is enabled. So if I'm, for example, going to change my impeller diameter, the plate angles at the trailing edge will be adjusted properly in order to meet our operation point. So in the next step, I'm going to switch to export action step. CF Turbo currently offers two export interfaces. One would be the export interface for all components. And we also offer the TurboGrid export interface for rotational symmetric components like stators or vane components like impellers and vane diffusers, for example. TurboGrid is not available for volutes, but in today's example, I want to choose the space claim example and select all three components. And I'm going to add them to the export actions list. And if I'm happy, I'm just click close. I close the dialog. And yeah, before I exit CF Turbo, you can see we also have a little gap between the impeller and the volute. And if I'm going to enter the CFD setup, you can see that this gap is automatically closed by CF Turbo by choosing an RSI connection to close the gap between the impeller and the volute. But I also enabled a small extension to the radial impeller to make sure that my outlet interface of the impeller does not sit exactly on the trailing edge. So I have a little the gap between the trailing edge and my outlet interface. Okay. So in the next step, I would exit Sieve Turbo. I will confirm the safe dialog. And I'm thrown back into the project schematic. As you can see, additional cells for the Sieve Turbo system has been created. So one for the inlet stator, one for the impeller, and one for the volute. And in brackets, you can see the export interface that has been chosen. In this case, it's the SpaceClaim export interface. You can also see that we have a parameter set. I will come back to this in a couple of seconds. So firstly, I want to create my exports by performing an update on the Sieve Turbo system. And now in the background, Sieve Turbo exports all the components into a step file format. A script logic is applied to all the geometries to transfer them to a SpaceClaim document file type with named selections. And this takes a couple of seconds. And in the meantime, I'm going to switch to the parameter set and take a closer look at the parameters we have enabled. As you can see, we have parameters. We have parameters available for the impeller outlet width, as well for the impeller diameter, the number of blades, and the swirl exponent of our volute. They have different values. Currently, they are grayed out because there's an update running in the background. You can always change units to a format you feel more comfortable with. And on the right-hand side of the parameter set, you can see our table of design points. So the name design points is a little bit misleading because we are only going to simulate one design point, but we are using this table to generate different geometry variations of our centrifugal pump. But we will come to be back to this a little bit later when we have set up our workflow. All right, so let's switch back to our project. So as I said, it takes a couple of seconds. This is mainly because SpaceClaim is started in the background and it takes roughly about half a minute to do this. The script logic itself is pretty fast with something about 5 minutes. Okay, and now you can see we have our exports have been created. And now I'm going to transfer our components to adjacent meshing systems. I'm going to transfer it to the mesh system and this as well. So we are going to mesh all the components separately and just to set up the workflow completely, I'm going to transfer the meshes that have not been created yet to a CFX system. And now I just need to update the geometry system and I could run it in the background. So this takes a little bit longer than usual. I'm not sure why it still requires an update because we already had our exports. Since the whole setup of workflow is time consuming, so all in all it takes roughly about 45 minutes to 1 hour until a simulation is ready to be started. I have prepared a similar workflow. So let me quickly switch to an already prepared workflow. And I'm going to open the meshing system. I have already done that of the impeller. So I've already meshed our components. And as I said, name selections are created automatically. And they will be available if you open ANSYS meshing. And Sieve Turbo automatically creates named selections for characteristic faces and parts. For example, we have a named selections for the impeller volume, but as well named selections for the impeller shroud, the outflow patch, the inflow patch, the impeller hub. as well as the blade edges and the blade sides. And you can use these name selections to fortify your workflow. So in this case, I have, for example, used the name selections to apply an inflation layer to my impeller just by selecting name selections as a scoping method. And then you're able to select from the different name selections. And for the boundary scoping method, I have chosen all the patches that I should be applied to. So this is one method to use the name selections that SieveTurbo automatically creates. A big benefit of this is if you decide to change your design, for example, you adjust the number of blades, all your mesh settings are still valid because they refer or they rely on name selections. So you don't need to go back to meshing, you just update the meshing processing and everything is fine. So that's a big benefit, and also that's the basis for an automatic turbo machine optimization. All right, so let's, as I said, I already have prepared. Quickly skip to the setup of the SieveTurbo system. I have already opened it, so this is what our pump would look like in SieveXpre. And also in SieveXpre, I have used the named selections to set up my model in a more robust way, and it's very comfortable using the named selections. For example, if you define a domain, you need to specify a location, and normally you would need to deal with these arbitrary IDs that ANSYS generates, but you could also use the named selections that were automatically created by SieveTurbo. This is especially helpful when you deal with a lot of wall boundary conditions, for example, since a model consists of a lot of different patches, which would again get arbitrary IDs, but you can also rely on the name selections that SieveTurbo have been created. Yes, you could also use name selections for the definition of expressions or monitoring points that will be available during the solver run. And you could also use name selections for the post-processing of CFD post. So in this case, this is the prepared model. You could create new expressions. And for example, if you want to perform a post-processing on the pressure force that is acting on maybe the impeller hub, you could then choose from different locations. In this case, you would also have access to all the named selections, which all start with NS underscore and then so on and so forth. All right. The next step after you have created or after you have set up your workflow, you maybe want to modify different geometry parameters to see how your performance of your pump changes. So in this case, I have closed the feedback loop. So I have defined efficiency and the pump head as an output parameter in CFD post. And if I go back into the parameter set, you can see we have the parameters of our current design. That's what I have enabled in SieveTurbo. Here you can see our output parameters from our simulation. So we achieved a head of 10 meters, which matches almost exactly our operation point with an efficiency of nearly 92%. So if we want to create new designs, we can go to the table of design points and see, for example, how our radial pump would perform with 7 plates, for example, or if I'm going to choose to select this 2 millimeter, or for example, with a with an outlet width of 30 millimeters or 35. So that's a very quick way to generate new geometry variants of your total machinery. You would just update your newly created design points. And since your whole workflow relies on named selections, it's very robust. So you do not need to go back into the meshing system or the pre-processing system. You just update these design points and the meshing process, as well as the setup and the CFD solver runs automatically. So this is almost ideal for an automatic total machine optimization, which could be done, for example, by attaching optimization systems to the parameter set. So I don't want to dive deeper into this. I just want to show it to you a little bit. For example, we could perform a response surface optimization by drag and dropping it into the parameter set. And in this case, you would still need to design your, or you would need to define your design of experiments by choosing a sampling method. For example, you could choose a Latin hypercube sampling. And of course, you would need to activate the parameters you want to vary, for example. So let me quickly do that. So for example, we want to perform a Latin hypercube sampling with 50 samples. I maybe only want to vary my outlet width as well as the impeller diameter. And yeah, and the next step, I could preview the samples that would be created. So as I only selected 10 numbers, so we will get 10 additional designs. If you click on the different parameters, you can specify lower and upper bounds in which the parameter will be varied. And yeah, in this case, you could start your design of experiments right away. And these 10 different geometry parameters would be calculated automatically, and you would get feedback about the pump efficiency and the pump head. But like I said, this is a little bit more advanced topic, and it takes a little bit more time to dive deeper into this and explain it further. So yeah, so I understand this is a very, very brief introduction how CF Turbo inside of ANSYS Workbench works. Of course, feel free to ask any questions. We can always dive deeper into specific systems, and yeah, I'm happy to answer your questions that mainly remain open.
Thanks a lot, Sasha. As Sasha said, is there anybody who's got any questions that you would like him to answer now for you?
Maybe we have one question quickly, Lara.
Yeah.
My question is, if you buy one license of CF Turbo, does that include both the functionality to use it as a standalone and to use it also in conjunction with ANSYS Workbench, or is there two separate licenses available for those functionalities?
Yeah, so I could answer this question. The license is focusing on CF Turbo only, but the Workbench extension is free for all CF Turbo users. So that means the license includes both features, standalone CF Turbo and the Workbench integration of CF Turbo. There's not a separate license necessary.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you.
Any further questions?
See, there's one in the chat.
Yeah.
The question is, can CF Turbo be used to design diffusers, return channels for multi-stage pumps? Yes, that's possible without any problem. So you can define crossover stator types and return channel, vaned or vaneless, and add another impeller in the system. So currently we are supporting three stages with the new version that we are releasing just in a few days. Five stages will be available in CF Turbo.
Okay, great. I don't know if there's any further questions. If anybody think of questions afterwards, you're welcome to send it to us and we can send it to Jera and Sasha to answer. Just a bit of housekeeping. Afterwards, we'll share this recording with everybody. And everybody that joined the session will have the opportunity to do a 10-day evaluation. So it will be valid from the 27th till the 2nd. So it's a very short period, but as you've seen the whole scope of the capabilities now, we want to make sure that the people who's interested is acting on it and take that evaluation up. So how that will work, there will be a follow-up email, as I said, with the recording and also with a link. And specific login details for users. So that will be shared, as I said, only with the attendees. It will be shared, if not this afternoon, tomorrow morning with everybody that joined the webinar. And I think that's everything from us now, unless there's anything else anybody want to share. No, so thanks everybody for your time and thanks again to CF Turbo for this great presentation and that we were able to share it with everybody and enjoy the rest of the day. Thanks.
Thank you everybody, have a great day.
Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, bye-bye.
Thank you, pleasure, bye.